Family Revival Center is a full gospel church located at 711 North Holly Street in Foley. Sunday school for all ages starts at 9:45, followed by morning worship at 10:30. Sunday and Wednesday evening services at 6 p.m. Join Pastor Tommy Howard and the Family Revival Center congregation as they study God's Word line upon line, precept upon precept. Family Revival Center, a full gospel church here for you. Family Revival Center is a full gospel church located at 711 North Holly Street.
6 months.
Count that way again. I'll
7 months. I'm special. I can do it backwards like that too.
I can sit out backwards.
So I'm excited about that. Coach supervised them the whole way, so I know they're installed properly.
We're blessed to have somebody that can be here to monitor.
Those were some fine guys. They knew what they were doing. He was a believer. One guy that talked to God to him was a little bit. He was a believer. People talk about, well, you can't do this, you can't. Well, if we're paying somebody and they're here doing something, we can ask them about anything we want to ask them.
That's right.
But it seemed like a little nice to go here. Amen. If you'd open your Bibles tonight to Luke chapter 15. Luke chapter 15. We're going to continue talking like we were last week. Last week we were talking about, we're coming into the Christmas season. We were talking about the reason Jesus came, to save souls. Amen. Matthew 1:21 says, "You shall call his name Jesus because he shall save his people from their sins." Amen. Aren't you glad tonight that's what Jesus does? So I'll continue talking about that, about the gospel, about sharing. I believe that, just like we were saying, just like with the people who came here and did some work, just simply, are you a believer? Just something to open the conversation up and see if there's somewhere you can go further with it. Just anything. It don't take much. We read all throughout the Word of God. If we'll just give God something to work with, He can do the miraculous. He can feed the multitude with just a lunch. He can part whatever seas in front of you with just you obeying the word. And God's good like that. He took down a whole dynasty through a young man and a rock. People trusting in God. Amen. So over in Luke 15, I want to read a few verses as we're starting out tonight. "Then drew near unto him," talking about Jesus, "all the publicans and sinners, for to hear him. And the Pharisees and scribes murmured, saying, This man receiveth sinners, and eateth with them. And he spake this parable unto them, saying, What man of you having 100 sheep, if he loses one of them, does not leave the 99 in the wilderness, and go after that which is lost until he finds it?" Say until. What would it mean that he went after it until? That means he didn't stop. That means the mission wasn't complete until he found what he was looking for. He didn't stop. He looked until he found him. Okay? "And when he had found it, he laid it upon his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he has come home, he called together his friends and neighbors, saying unto them, Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep which was lost. I say unto you that likewise joy shall be in heaven over one sinner that repenteth more than over 99 just persons who need no repentance. Either," verse 8, "either what woman, having 10 pieces of silver, if she loses one piece, does not light a candle and sweep the house and seek diligently till," somebody say till, Luke 15, "seeks diligently till she finds it." Well, in other words, she's searching until she finds what she was looking for. How was she searching? Diligently, the King James says. How would one know in the process of their search if they had been diligent or not? How would one know that? Because they found what they were looking for. You can begin diligent, but to end diligent, you have to find what it is you've been looking for, okay? "And when she hath found it, she calleth her friends and her neighbors together, saying, Rejoice with me, for I have found the peace which I had lost. Likewise," verse 10, I say unto you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner that repenteth. Over one sinner that repenteth. You know, we as believers, as Christians, have a responsibility to reach out with the gospel. We do well to not forget that. With all the things that we walk around perhaps in our daily life presenting, that we're to be presenting the gospel to reach the lost. You know, my job as a pastor, or one of them, in my opinion, is to be sure that our church is responding to that mandate, to that call to the lost, the way Jesus taught we should. And he goes on. The way that Jesus taught that we should respond to the lost. Is that better?
Oh, now we can see you.
See like that? Ooh, I saw the light. Amen. We need to share the light. You know, it's a top priority. Matthew 18:11 says, for the Son of Man is come to save that which is lost. Okay? Matthew 1:21, kind of our theme verse from last week. You shall call his name Jesus. You're talking about what the angel told Joseph about the baby that Mary was having. You shall call his name Jesus because he shall save his people from their sins. You know, Matthew 28, that Jesus tells us, what we call the Great Commission, that all power is given unto me in heaven and earth, therefore go. He's talking to believers. He's talking to the church. He's talking to those who would call themselves his disciples. Go. I mean, that's still ringing, you know, some 2,000 some odd years later, he's still saying go. Go, teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I commanded you, and I'm with you. He says, I'm with you. Amen? I'm with you. He's with us today when we go. When we go and share the gospel. Notice that big go right at the beginning of the word gospel. You know, when we go and share the gospel, he's with us. He's the empowerment of it. Jesus is serious about this gospel outreach business. Now, in our two parables that we read here in Luke 15, something of value was lost, okay? In the first one, a sheep was lost. And in the second one, a coin was lost. Now notice, nobody, including the ones he was speaking to, remember he's speaking to the religious leaders of the day, the publicans, the scribes, he's telling them these stories, okay, or giving these illustrations. Nobody, including them, who they valued material things, okay, nobody would ignore such a loss, okay? As a matter of fact, when he starts off in verse 4, he says, what man? What man of you, in other words, who would not go after that sheep? You know, well, we all would. And when referring to the lady, he goes, verse 8, he goes, either what woman would not go after looking for that coin? Well, all of them would. You know, all people would do this. You know, nobody would just ignore such a loss, okay? Referring to something of value. They'd put forth every effort into finding these things, and they'd be happy when they did. They'd be rejoicing. And so I was thinking, if that's the case for things that are lost, how much more so for people who are lost? Amen? How much more value does, you know, if we put that kind of value on a thing that is misplaced or lost, how much more value should we put on a life that is lost, spiritually speaking, separated from God? Well, Jesus, I can tell you the price that the Father put on him. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish. For this cause, the Son of Man came, that, you know, to seek that which was lost. He put the highest price on a lost soul, trying to bring them back into relationship. Man was created, guys. We were created for a relationship with God. And when we're not in relationship with God, nothing is right in our lives. I'm just telling you plain. You may think, folk may think that it is, but it's not. If the foundation isn't sure, what you build on it is not going to be. There's going to be a problem somewhere down the road. Okay. See, one of the problems that I believe that we have today is that so many are not in a right relationship with God. I said a right relationship with God. I didn't say so many don't walk around saying they're Christians. I didn't say not many people walk around saying that they're born again. I said there's not a whole lot that doesn't seem that are walking around with the relationship that God wants to be in with them. You know, And that's just the truth. I don't know what that number is, but I know it's not 100%. I can tell you that. That's what God would like for it to be. And so, if that relationship isn't right, if that relationship isn't in order, then ultimately nothing else in that life can be. Nothing else can be in order. You know, that's the start. Hello. If God's not center, how can the rest of your life run true in the sense of plumb, in the sense of level, or in the sense of square? How can it? And people don't see that, because the Bible says the God of this world is blinded the eyes of those who believe not. They don't see that. You know, one of the definitions for the word true means to make balanced or even, to be true. You know, to be balanced, to be even, to be right. So when we say lost tonight, we're referring to people, we're talking about those who are not born again, those who are outside of the house of God, so to speak, but whom God wants to be inside the house. Okay? God desires to come home, like the prodigal son. You know, we're going to read his story in just a moment. You know, verse 32, the father says, he was lost, but now he is found. Okay? Praise God. In other words, restored, when we get to that story in just a second, he's restored to a proper father-son relationship. He was lost, and now he's found. And it's a picture of the God-man relationship that God wants to have with us. You know, man was lost, but man can be found. Man can be restored, amen? So really, when he gives us the illustration of a coin or a sheep, he's really referring to people who are spiritually lost. It's people that those things in the parables represent. It's people that the lost sheep represented that the man went after so diligently, and the woman in that coin, that's people that he's referring to, illustrating with that she went after, and our response to them, how our response to them should be. How many believe tonight that we should respond to lost people in a greater way than we respond to lost stuff? You know, I can confess tonight, not the best confession, how one might act, being me, when I can't find the keys to my car. And I know I left them right there. And they're not right there. Look in the last place you left them. Well, I'm looking there and they're not there. Or my wallet. You know, my wallet that has access to my physical empire. You know. Did I leave that somewhere? You know what I'm saying? Did it fall out my pocket? The remote. The remote. Now I'm doing, you know, my cell phone is in the truck. Y'all know that. But I think sometimes I probably overreact to looking for that kind of stuff when it's lost. Where is it at? It doesn't matter what the two boys are doing. If they're at home, they have to stop it. And everybody has to, you can ask them, they have to stop whatever they're doing, and we have to search diligently. How do we know we've been diligent? Because we don't stop until we find it. And usually it's in one, it's the weirdest thing. You ever notice how usually when you find it, it's in that spot you look four times. And now all of a sudden it just appeared there. You know? It's a strange thing. But isn't a lost soul more valuable than lost stuff? I mean, you know, obviously in these parables, like all the Word of God, there's all kinds of things that we could be talking about, but are points that could be made. But I want to make this point tonight, that whenever the lost was found, whenever the lost is found, there's great rejoicing that takes place. Mm-hmm. You know, when I find the remote, hey, you know, we're leaving whatever channel it was on, and we're going to the game, you know. I find the keys, and, you know, of course, I wasn't looking for the keys until it was time to leave. And now, all of a sudden, I'm behind schedule because the keys weren't where they're supposed to be. I don't know why somebody would leave my keys on me like that. It don't make no sense to me. What about here? Whenever the lost is found, verse 6, it says, when he comes home, he calls together his friends and neighbors, saying unto them, rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep, which was lost. Verse 9. And when she found it, the coin, she called her friends and her neighbors together, saying, rejoice with me, for I have found the peace which I have lost. Now, see, that's what I'm missing at the house. I just dawned on it. When I find my stuff, nobody rejoices with me. You're like, where? I told you where. That's what we're missing. We're not rejoicing after we find stuff. But here, verse 10, likewise, back to the Bible. Likewise, I say unto you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner that repenteth. Okay? Glory to God. Over one sinner. When the lost are found, heaven rejoices. Amen? Wouldn't we like heaven to record, there's a party due to 711 North Holly Street tonight. A sinner came home, somebody who was lost was found, recorded in the Chronicles of Heaven, you know what I mean? Whenever God's grace is received by man, angels go wild. We should too. We should, man, it should inspire us to be more involved. So let's continue reading here tonight, Luke 15, verse 11. And he said, a certain man had two sons. Okay, he's continuing what he was talking about. And the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me. And he divided unto them, say them, his living. Okay, the younger brother, the younger son wants his inheritance, but and he gets it, but so does the elder brother too. He divided the inheritance to them, to both his sons. The younger son got his one-third, and the elder brother got two-thirds. Because understand, tradition is that the elder son got a double portion, so two-thirds would be a double of one-third, correct? Three-thirds making a whole. Okay, y'all with me? So he got his third, all right? He got his third. His brother got his two-thirds. Tradition, I guess we'll call it that, holds that the older brother got two-thirds because he was to continue taking care of the father and the family, so he received the extra portion. But, it's also been said I read somewhere along the line that when the younger son asked for his inheritance, in one sense, before its time, it was the equivalent in Middle Eastern culture of basically saying, I'm eager for you to die, Dad, so I can get what's coming to me. It had that same, that's the same equivalence when this younger son's saying, hey, I want my portion. Because normally this stuff wasn't divided out till. So verse 13, and not many days, and he divided unto them his living, and not many days after, the younger son gathered all together. I underlined that in my Bible because I was thinking that must have meant it was substantial. He had to gather all of it. It wasn't like, a purse, a pocketful. He gathered all together. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. Wasted his substance. It's like a song. Leaves home, goes to a far country. And I like what it started off. That verse starts off, and the coach says, and not many days after he got it, he left. And I thought, that sounds about right. I'm just talking right now, but this younger son, we're going to talk about some things about him. I think immature because of his actions. He's got this payday. Not looking to the future or a rainy day or anything like that. It's like, hey, no sense hanging around here and having to work. like I've been doing, having to do this, that, and the other. So it didn't take him many days to decide that he was out there. Do his own thing. Spend every dime, the Bible says, that he had. A couple points we can make here. I believe that we can see that the young man was probably selfish. Selfishness is a characteristic of immature person. Immature people are almost always selfish people. It's all about them. It's all about them. I want my money and I want it now. All he could see was that here and now, that this is what I want to do. There's no thinking of tomorrow or the future or forget family. I want mine. Okay, that's selfish. When it's all about me, that's being selfish. That's immature. I mean, they just can't get around that. So many people are all about me, and there's no thought in their mind beyond that. Just me, mine, and here now, and when I say immature, I think of a young child. Don't get their way. Why? Why? Because they want their way. Why? Why do they respond like that? Because they're immature.
No.
And they'll continue to do that until, you know, circumstances change or they win, as my wife would say. And then you may find yourself in a worse situation. The Bible says you have to a far country. Now, let me understand. Before you go to a far land physically, you can go there inside. You can check out inside. You know, mentally, I don't guess is the word I'm looking for. But the Bible says, as a man thinketh, so is he. Before you physically remove yourself, you can remove yourself. Y'all don't understand what I'm saying? I said, before you physically remove yourself, you can remove yourself. I believe here it probably denoted a distance. But you can be in a far country inside your heart. There's marriages where people are in two different countries, okay? That, you know, than where they should be. You can be outside of God's will. I mean, just one step out of God's will. And that's a far country. That's a distant land for a believer, because we're supposed to be in his will, spiritually speaking. So he's in a far country. He's outside his father's will. He's wasted everything he got. We call him the prodigal. The prodigal. And I looked up the word prodigal just to make sure, you know, I was clear on what it meant. It means recklessly extravagant or wasteful. Prodigal. Okay? Understand, he wasn't a prodigy. A prodigy means something or someone that's exceptionally talented. That's a prodigy. A prodigy and a prodigal are not the same. Prodigal's bad. Okay? Now for Rusty, now he might have lived. Say it for me, prodigiously, which means large. I don't mean to do that. I didn't do that until I looked at the next word on my little thing. Prodigiously. It doesn't mean prodigy or prodigal. It means something. It means large. He might have lived large for a while, but we find out that he wasn't living that way at this point. He made a long list of bad decisions. I mean, sin always works that way. Bad decisions. One bad decision after another. First you lie, then you have to tell another lie to cover a lie. Once you start down that path, guys, it'll just keep leading you to the next bad decision. You know what I'm saying? That's why when we repent, we turn. You know, but lying just leads you to the next bad decision. Pretty soon, 27 bad decisions later, you're down the road. You know what I'm saying? I said 18 years later, all you have is a history of bad decisions, right? Verse 14 says this, and when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want. I was thinking for our point purposes tonight, whenever you leave God, you'll always find yourself in a famine. You'll always find yourself lacking whenever you separate from God. Oh, it may look good for a season. That's the deceitfulness of sin. People don't sin because of how terrible it's going to be. It's the pleasure of sin that lasts just for a season, the Bible says. Or at least we build that way. It may look good for a season. I said some enjoy sin for a season, but when the money runs out or the music stops or you're broke, and then all your good time buddies who were hanging with you while you had the party flowing, they all of a sudden can't be found. I mean, I'm talking from experience. Then you realize, it just was for a season. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would fain have filled his belly with the husk. Fain means been well. He would have been well pleased. That's his old English. He'd been well pleased, or he'd been perfectly happy to have filled his belly with the husk that the swine did eat, what he was feeding the pigs with, and no man gave unto him. So I was thinking, no man gave unto him. He joined himself to a citizen of that country, and it sounds like this guy's doing him some favor, but the next verse, he ain't even giving him what he's giving to pigs. That's what happens when you hook up with those who aren't of the household of God. Those of a far country, of all them good time buddies who are there when the party's going on, who are there when they can get something off of you. But then when you want something, all he wanted was to be fed with what he was feeding pigs with. And it wasn't taking place. It wasn't happening. He lost everything. Now think about this. Young man who had come from a good family, godly family, sleeping with the pigs, okay? But, you know, sometimes it's when folk come face to face with the pigs that they think about returning home. So Sometimes when they come face to face with the pigs, they think about returning home. Now, I wasn't raised in church, but, you know, with so many, that's the case. I don't know how many people, you know, because I run with church people nowadays, you know, obviously, that they were their parents raised them in church, and then they got sidetracked, and then they came back, you know, or they didn't come back. So many raised, and I think of my own children. I'm glad that, you know, I'm glad that I drag them to church as much as I can. You know what I'm saying? I know that's how they feel sometimes. I want them to stay in afterwards when I don't have as much influence or control. Verse 17 says, when he came to himself, when he came to his senses. In other words, he was acting contrary to how he was raised. That wasn't who he was raised to be, how he was acting. He came to his senses. He said, when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father's house have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger. He came to his senses. I'm telling you, friend, sin, those type of decisions, it's just senseless. It costs you. I read one place before where somebody called it temporary spiritual insanity, the sin. When a poor believer is it's like temporary spiritual insanity. What was I thinking? Why in the world did I do that? That could describe us when we forsake the living waters that God offers us to drink out of the sewers of this world. When God freely said, "Whosoever thirsts, let him come to me and drink, and I'll give them living water." But I'll drink out of the sewer that the garbage that this world's offering me. My question, what was it that brought him back to his senses? What caused him to come to himself in the story that we just read?
Rock bottom,
that's a great way to describe it. What was it rock? Well, that's a good answer. Somebody give me another answer. That's the answer I'm going to in a minute in a different way. But what was it specifically? He was hungry. Before he got to remembering back, he was hungry. He was hungry. I'm fixing to preach right now. So. Watch this. God, the Lord spoke to me. It wasn't because he realized how terrible he was. Mm-hmm. It wasn't because he looked at himself and said, "I'm just a bad person." No, he was hungry. Good time buddies were gone. Didn't have no more money. There was a rumbly in his tumbly. You know what I'm saying? He was hungry. Okay? It wasn't because he realized how terrible he had been. Okay? At least not yet, it wasn't. So often we think that we can just tell people how bad they are, and that will cause them to change. What did you say, Rusty, so many times? It's
rock bottom.
Rock bottom. We find out that causes people to change, unfortunately. It's not so many times we want to help somebody, but what we're doing is we're telling them how wrong they are. We're telling them how bad they are. We're telling them how terrible of a person they are. That ain't caused hardly anybody to ever change. But that rock bottom business has caused a lot of people to change. I'm not saying that's always the solution, but I'm saying so many times it takes somebody hitting, and I wrote down rock bottom. Notice the father wasn't sending groceries to where he was so at least he could have something to eat while he was doing his own thing. No, the father said, go on with your bad self. Hit rock bottom. He wasn't sustaining him in the middle of all that garbage that he was, how he was living his life and the decisions he was making. Well, at least he'll have something. No, the father didn't go anyway. Father was there for him. We find out when he came to his senses, but he didn't sustain him while he was in the middle of his thing. No, he let him get that. Yes, sir.
I tell one of these people that iniquity of those people was fully.
That's exactly right. So I think that was when Moses and them were taking the land, and he said, they hadn't hit rock bottom in one sense. But sometimes we think we're helping people. We think we're being compassionate. We think we're doing right. Here's his boy. He didn't have spies out there watching over his boy, making sure he had something to eat. Making sure he had this, that, and no. He just let him. Because you know what? It could be that as long as he had something to eat, he'd be sitting there until he could come up with the next scam or idea that would sustain him. I know so many people get addicted to drugs and stuff, and as long as they can get a fix, whether it be stealing or working for a minute or this, that, and the other, well, they're all right. When they hit that rock bottom, they can't even get the dope that helped them get to bottom no more. Then they start, I ain't even getting high no more, you know what I'm saying? But as long as somebody come around with a little baggie, they can all sit around and misery loves company together, well, they go a little longer. I know this to be true. See, the truth is people often seek the Lord, watch this, out of some need when they have nowhere else to go. And guess what? God is okay with that. I know we can be judgmental. Oh, you want to listen to me now. Now you want to talk Jesus. But Jesus isn't like that. Okay. You know what Jesus is like? No matter how you came to the decision. It doesn't even matter if you think, you know, it's like when we had the food pantry ministry years ago. It never failed. Every once in a while somebody would come along because, you know, you can help people and they needed help. And then there's others who might not have needed as much help. Some people just won't get theirs. They're going to get whatever they get their hands on, no matter what, you know, this, that, and the other. And that's all right. I can remember. Remember one time a statement was made. That's not even. They're just stealing. You can't steal this stuff. We're giving it away. We're giving this stuff away. You can't steal it from us. Yeah. Now, you have a legitimate need. I mean, if I discerned that the need wasn't legitimate, then you're not getting as much as the person, you know, who you discern's got a real need, you know. But, you know, God, I've been calling you since you was a young child. I sent the prophet, the preacher, this, your mama, your daddy, all these people out, and now, no, it's too late. That's not how God is. I'm all a little weary, heavy laden. Sometimes people just aren't weary enough. You'd think they were, but they're not. Some people, unfortunately, aren't laid it down enough. Laid it enough. You know, you'd think that they were when you look at their life, but. We ought to receive people, even if it's just because they have a need. Amen. Who do we think we are when we decide that we know a person's heart, we can see inside it and see whether they're genuine or not? We should just take that face value to a degree, those things. Because the power isn't in and of us, it's of the Lord. The Lord can turn at any time. The Lord, that word can get in there and change our heart at any time that heart will open up and receive that seed. For whatever reason the conversation started. Even if they don't even realize that they have a problem. Even if one doesn't even realize that the root of the issue is their cross. If we can do that, I believe that will help cause them to see their real need, and that being Jesus. The Bible says in Romans 2:4 that the goodness of God, it's the goodness of God that leads man to repentance. Repentance. Real repentance. Repentance. Repentance, simply stated, this is a good definition. It's a changing of mind that leads to a changing of life. Changing of heart. Repentance, first and foremost, is a changing of mind. That's literally what it means, that you change your mind. That leads to a changing of your life. Okay, that's real repentance. See, it was his need that got him thinking about going home, how good they had it at home. And it's then that he realized the error of his ways. He's hungry tonight because of his decisions, okay? That's why he was hungry, you know, his decisions. So many people are suffering because of bad decisions. They're sleeping with pigs because they've been pig-headed, all right? Verse 18, he says, I will arise and go to my father, and will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee. And I'm no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. See, that we're talking real repentance. Real repentance means admitting that you are the one responsible for the situation you're in. Okay? That's real repentance. You change your mind and it's going to change your life. You're the responsible one. You got to be honest with yourself. That's what he's doing. He's being honest with himself. You know, if you really want change, you'll stop making excuses for why you act, how you act. As long as you're making excuses for your behavior, then there won't be any change. As soon as it, as long as it's, you know, as soon as it's not dad's fault or not the older brother's fault or not, you know, but it's my fault. When one stops making excuses, they aren't far from the kingdom. They're not far from the kingdom. So he repents. He humbles himself. Look what he says in verse 19. I'm not even worthy to be called thy son. He humbled himself. Repentance comes with no preconditions. You know what I mean? You know, so many parents and kids today, they are just relationships in general. I'll come back if, blah, 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 blah. You'll let me do this, or I'll do this if. No, real repentance doesn't come with preconditions. You know, you're not cutting a deal. You know what I'm saying? There's no taking responsibilities when you're cutting a deal in the situation. Okay? Real repentance doesn't make deals with God. And he arose and came to his father. But when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. In other words, he made up his mind and he did it. He got moving. His father sees him and is moved with compassion. My boy. You know what I mean? Father sees him because he's been looking for it. My boy. It's not a lack of love because the father wasn't sending, you know, ambassadors over there checking on him, and, you know, people over there dropping him off to, you know, make sure he had, you know, sandwich to eat or something like that. It wasn't, oh, he's not compassionate. He doesn't love. No, it was love. He was concerned about his son. He was looking for his son, but he had to do what he had to do. Okay? The boy's problems were his decisions. He was living with the result of his decisions. Okay? And so the father sees him, and my boy, and what a great moment. The son's come home. I wonder how long the son had been gone. I wonder how long he'd been waiting on. I wonder how long it took him to spend his inheritance and have nothing and come to his senses. I wonder how long that was. It doesn't matter how long it was, the father was still there waiting on him. Whether it was 2 weeks, a month, six months, a year, the father was looking for him. Recognized him when he saw him. Probably didn't look the same. He left with all his gathered together stuff. Probably healthy. Somebody who's hungry doesn't look the same. They've been hungry for a while, making their way back. All that heavy weight on laying them down, decisions of life and all that. But yet he recognized them. Father looking for him. That makes me want to believe that he was believing that he was going to come home. What great confidence. He's coming back. How do you know? Because I trained him up in the way he should go, and I know when he gets older, he's not going to be. Because I've been believing God, and we've been, you know, praying and trusting God and standing on the word. He's coming back. And say amen. Amen. And it happened. Isn't that wonderful about the word of God? You stand on the word of God, and it happens. You trust God, and you stand on his word, and it comes to pass. Surely it'll come to pass. So he runs to him, embraces him, kissing him. I love it. He doesn't care what had happened between them. He was glad he was back. The son said unto him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and in thy sight. I'm no more worthy to be called thy son. Started that speech here. Remember when he came to himself way back in the pig pen? I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to go home. I'm going to tell Father I've sinned against heaven, against him. I'm not even. That whole speech. That when he came to his senses and the whole, wherever he was coming from, however far of a distance he traveled, you know he was rehearsing in his mind what he was going to say. It was ingrained in him. And so he gets there Father! And the father does not even let him finish the speech. He doesn't even get to that. He repents. He repents. That's all we need to do. We don't need to work. Try to cut some kind of deal. We need to repent. He repents. And the father says, and the father receives him. Glory to God. How many know the son doesn't have to cut a deal to come back? A son can be received. Glory to God. When we repent for our ways, God doesn't do it based on some deal with us. Based on what Jesus Christ has did. We've admitted our need for him. Amen. But the father said to his servants, bring forth the best robe, put it on, put a ring on his hand, shoes on his feet. By Jesus, we put on garments of praise and robes of righteousness. Amen. We trade our filthy robe, our righteousness, that filthy thing that we claim, that we present, you know, ourselves with, and we exchange it for God's glorious righteousness. And bring out the fatted calf. Kill it. Let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they begin to make him merry. Glory to God. I mean, he kissed him, representing forgreatness. Brought out the best robe, status symbol. Amen. Fully restored. That ring was a sign of authority. I mean, he was a son, okay? He's a son. He's not earning his way back. He's not make me as a hired servant. He's the son. Shoes and sandals was a sign of freedom, a position. Slaves went around barefoot, not a son. A son was with his clothes. They had a feast. It was a joyful welcome. It was a special occasion. And verse 24 says they begin to be merry. The party was on. Everybody was happy. Happy, happy. Well, almost everybody. There was one guy. Let's read about him. Now, his elder son, in other words, the prodigal's brother, flesh, his flesh and blood. His elder son was in the field, and as he came and drew nigh to the house, he heard the music, and he heard the dancing, and he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. Now, sometimes we need to picture the scene. I know I wasn't there, but I'm going to show y'all what this looked like. What's going on back in the house? You know what I'm saying? It wasn't like, don't misunderstand this and think he was like, what's going on back here at the house? No. That brother's been gone. Brother's the last thing on his mind. All he knows is he's coming out in the fields. La, 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 la. You know, they're doing the song. It smells like barbecue. I don't know. You know what I'm saying? Hey, what's going on? That I would imagine that was how he, hey, what's going on back here? You know, what's going on? You know? He walks out there, comes home, there's a party. One of the servers says, hey, 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 your brother's come home and your father's celebrating. What? Then with that, and we don't have to imagine, the Bible tells us that basically this guy was jealous, he was angry, he was sulking, he was pouting, he was mad, wouldn't even go inside the house. Did I read it out to you? Well, let me read it. And he called one of the servants, asked what these things meant, and he said unto him, thy brother has come, thy father has killed the fatted calf because he has received him safe and sound. And he was angry, would not go in. Therefore his father came out and entreated him. And he answered, said to his father, you know what? All these years I've been serving you, and I've never done anything wrong. I've done everything you said, and not even one time have I went against what you said, and you never even gave me just a little bitty old goat just to have some fun with my friends. But as soon as this thy son was come, which has devoured thy living with harlots, thou hast killed for him the fatted calf. Oh man, he goes off. He goes off. How many thinks he was making everything about himself? Okay. It was about, he had a self issue in his own self, just like his brother did, a little bit different though. Thy sons come. Remind me of Priscilla. When Priscilla gets aggravated at me, she'll say to Samantha, my wife, she'll go, your husband, blah, blah, blah. You won't say that, she'll go, your husband is doing something, blah, 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 blah. You know what I'm saying? That son comes back home after hanging out with all those good-for-nothing friends of his, spending everything that you gave him, and you want to have a party. Oh, I know siblings. I've been that sibling. And I'm not the only one in this room who's probably been that sibling to some degree or another, in some form of passion. He's resentful. Some of us might have been like that, probably. Okay? Self-centered. Some of us may have been like that elder brother. Self-righteous. Huh.
there.
I'm going to get covered. It's unfair. Take my voice. I'm going to leave. I'm not going inside. I'm not going in there. He had self issue too. He had an overinflated image of himself. Notice how the older, I say that because of how the older brother describes himself. All these years I've served you. I did this. He didn't mention, and dad gave me 2/3 of everything he had. Didn't mention that part. All these years I've worked for you. Never disobeyed you. Probably a stretch. Sometimes we forget how many times we've been forgiven in our past. When it comes to ourselves, we forget it's all where we come from. And ultimately, of course, it's the Father's problem. It's like Adam in the garden. God, this woman you gave. Adam, what did you do? It wasn't me. It was the woman you gave me, God. The son, you don't do nothing for me. When this, when your favorite son comes home, man, you just roll out the red carpet. You have to watch out for self-righteousness. And I'm not even joking. You know, Jesus was, he was tender towards all kind of folk with issues, sinners. I mean, thieves, adulterers, just everything. But when it came to those who were self-righteous, he didn't have a whole lot of tolerance for them. Hello? I say, Jesus will help you with your issues. That's one, but when the issue is you, there's not much he can do for you if you're not going to participate in that one. I mean, when it came to self-righteousness, he let them have it. Who warned you, Pharisee? Remember, that's John the Baptist. John the Baptist hit on who warned him. Pharisee said, hey, you know, they're going to make it into heaven before you. I mean, Jesus did. Self-righteousness always tries to justify itself when it's found out. There is no true, real repentance when self-righteousness is present. Because you ain't changed your mind about it. And so it's not going to result in a change in that life. You ain't changed your mind whenever self-righteousness is present. It always tries to justify itself. I understand. Come on. Isn't there a view in which this son's attitude could be justified? I mean, after all, who wouldn't feel like that older brother felt? Huh? That's the deceitfulness of self-righteousness. That's the deceitfulness of it. See, there's always a problem when we compare ourselves one with another. You know, the Bible says, don't compare yourself one to another. It's not wise. You want to compare yourself to someone, compare yourself to Jesus. Don't compare yourself to, you know, I'm not going to compare myself to Doug. I'm not going to compare myself, to Wyatt or Kathy. You ever notice when we compare ourselves to other people, usually we compare ourselves to somebody who we think's got more issues than us, so we come out feeling a little bit better. Well, he's not, remember the Pharisee? He's not a sinner. That's the deceitfulness of being self-righteous. One person said it like this about the American church. He said, the American church is long on mad, short on grace. Mad at politicians, media, sinners, and anyone who lives life differently than we do. Just chewing on that. So there's a stall. We need to stop being mad at people. Amen? We're talking about leading people to the gospel. It's the goodness of God. We need to stop being mad at people. You know, the Bible's very clear. You know, it's not people are our problem. We don't battle against flesh and blood, do we? Do we? But against powers and principalities and spiritual wickedness in high places. See, it's not. I understand that it's always flesh and blood that's in your face, so you think that's who you're ultimately fighting. But ultimately, they're just a pawn. Ultimately, they're just a puppet.
I'm with you, self-righteousness.
Yeah. Lost people sin because they're lost. Christians sin because they're not perfect either. Maybe folks should stop being angry at people who sin differently than they do. Self-righteousness thinks it's better than others. If that's us, if that's us, how are we going to be gracious to somebody who is outside the household of God? We're so full of ourselves, how are we going to be gracious to somebody who's lost? Somebody who needs the Lord? We're not. We're going to somehow be scratching some itch of our own to make ourselves feel even more, you know, righteous. I mean, there's a big party going on because lost folk are coming home and even angels are celebrating. Are we going to join in? Are we going to soak outside and be critical? We're going to swell up. We're going to be like Opie Taylor kicking a can down the road. You know, cheeks all blowed out, you know, just swallowed up. We need to learn from the Father in this story. Somebody read verse 31 and 32. We need to be like this guy. 31 and 32.
That we should make merry and be glad, but this thy brother was dead and is alive again, was lost and is found.
So that's what we need to learn from right there. Here's a father who goes out to the rebel child as he's returning. Here's a father who deals with the pouting son. You know, in other words, he's compassionate to all. Okay, compassionate to all. Now I wonder. In that parable, guys, who really ended up being lost? Because we don't know if the elder son ever changed his mind. I'm not saying he didn't. But I know that the one that you think's lost, he's found. But what about this other guy? Man, he's not going back in the house. I'm not going to church. I'm not serving the Lord. I've had things about me. That's how that plays out. Maybe he got his heart right for him to join the celebration. Now, remember that coin that woman lost? That coin was lost in the house. It can be in the house and lost. Mm-hmm. Remember who this story was addressed to. It was addressed to those Pharisees and those Sadducees who had that same spirit as that older brother. Somebody read Luke 15, verse 1 through 3 again, real quick. Anybody got a Bible open?
1 through 3?
Yes.
By this time, a lot of men and women of doubtful reputation were hanging around Jesus, listening intently. The Pharisees and religion scholars were not pleased, not at all pleased. They growled, "He takes in the sinners and eats meals with them, treating them like old friends." Their grumbling triggered this story.
Sure sounds like that older brother part, doesn't it? I remember one time the Bible says, one of the preachers of the day said, really wonder about them. They're not like us. Sinners. We can find ourselves in this story tonight. I hope we do anyway, not as the prodigal or the elder brother, but like the father. So we've been the younger brother at one time, or we've been the elder brother. We don't need to remain that.